satisfied with them. Got any questions, then Nick's more than happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Lovely, thanks.
I'm sure this Ian responded, but John first.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks very much. Thank you very much for the excellent presentation and the interesting video. Just the most concern, really, I think, as we all know, the greatest barrier to cycling is perceptions of safety. And I think that's a huge issue. And across the 10 cities across the UK, that will be an issue of paramount importance. I'm just wondering how we propose to do it in the local city region. I note with interest, for example, in Edinburgh, they've got 126 miles of separate cycle tracks to the main road network. I'm just wondering how we could actually go about undertaking something similar to that in the local city region. And that might be a big ask, but that's perhaps something we ought to consider. Thank you, Chair.
I absolutely couldn't agree more on that one. We know from the research that we've done, more people in the city region want to cycle, but safety is the number one concern that they have. And people want to see segregated off-road cycle routes work, people put them in, particularly women. There's a huge gender mismatch between the number of people cycling in the city region. I think 86% of all cycling trips made by men between the ages of 25 and 39. Where we will pick this up is through the local cycling and walking infrastructure plan, which I mentioned earlier. And this is something that we'll be bringing to the Transport Committee and future date for members to take a view on that one as we go a little bit further. And this is very much around building a strategic cycling walking network in the city region that, wherever possible, will be fully segregated away from traffic.
Gordon and then Jeff, and then Francis.
Thanks very much, Jim. The point that's been raised about safety is one of the ones that I'm really, really concerned about. It's when you've looked at the different people who have consulted on it, I wonder how many people would be like myself who many years ago would ride a bike as a regular thing, but now would be very reticent to get back on the saddle, because the point is made by the council stop, absolutely right. I noticed when I look at statistics, one of the things that I do find is that it's looked at the cost of potholes, for example. So £40 million across whichever area it was, and the spent by local authorities with insurance given in place. It was saying that the payout for a motor was around about £900 for the claim, £11,000 for self-rescue. That would be bad. So that's the first one thing we have for that one. The second one is on the equalities impact. And it looked at all the groups that would be involved. And I wondered if there was any discussion with elderly people about how they could engage that, because I've noticed when you drive a car, you don't notice how much of a hill it is. It seems pretty flat, but when you're on a bike, that suddenly becomes quite a long journey uphill. But I see bikes in Spain and places that I go to that have a battery built into the pillars called on the rear. Is that a part of cycling? Thanks for that. It's a bit long in the chair.
E-bikes is absolutely going to transform cycling in the next 10 years. Already the sales of new bikes is rapidly taking off, and the technology is getting more efficient, it's getting cheaper, it's getting more accessible. And what the Bike Life report is about is showing that actually everyone wants to cycle. This isn't just for young and fit people, this is for everyone, this is for the young, this is for the old as well, and everyone in between. And the Bike Life reports, they're not. We don't just ask cyclists, this is asking every this is a cross section of the population. Just asking cyclists what they want, asking the people of your city what they want from their city. And so far, the responses from all of the cities have shown pretty consistently that people in cities in this country want more cycling, because they see that the benefits to their city, not just for those people that are on bikes, but for everyone. And then in terms of
I think if you get the idea that people sometimes want to drive bikes,
know the reasons and the barriers, then we work with John and his team to address those barriers, solve them, and build resilience to cycling. It isn't something that happens overnight. It needs commitment, it needs commitment to the infrastructure, it needs commitment to be a change programs. But Mersey Travel, they're really excited about this project. They've got great commitment to it, and we're really looking forward to working with Mersey Travel on this. Because we see potential benefits to Liverpool, as John said. If you hit your targets here, we can transform Liverpool, that's not nowhere else in the UK. So,
just
to
go back on the safety issue, I think you're right. One of the things that particularly was critical in our journey strategy is the reasons why people don't walk and cycle more, particularly for shorter journeys. And that's a little bit of a gap in our knowledge base. So what we're going to do is engaging team with Mersey Travel to set some focus groups up. And they were primarily set to test new products like online platforms and e-services and things like that. I've spoken to the head of service there, and got an agreement from her that we use those focus groups, and there's five of them, young people, things of older people, and do some specific work with them on the regions as to why they don't walk the side of the wall. You'll then use those results to build a much bigger piece of research that we're planning to do if we're going to do all of this walking and cycling investment, we expect the return to society to be on there. Another piece of work that we can do, and then all of that information will be fed through to our friends and such friends as we move towards building the first report for the city region in 2020.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chair. Excellent report, just tick all the boxes on transport. You emphasise on safety, and the report seems to emphasise a lot of safety for motorists and cyclists, but there's another aspect of safety, and that's cyclists and pedestrians. So we need to get that in there. No doubt each and every one of the members in here today are heard as I do in my ward, whereby cyclists go through shopping centres, God knows what, everything else, in a cavalier fashion, knocking down the elderly. I'm not saying to everybody, but it does happen. And I think there needs to be some emphasis on that, about cycling safety and the responsibility of that.
Absolutely. We're not trying to say cycling has got real benefits, but yes, you're right, pedestrians have got rights too. We're a cycling and walking charity. Bike Life is about cycling, but we want people to be more safely as well. And if you look at safety in terms of walking, still the biggest threat if you're a pedestrian is from motor vehicles. I'm not saying that we should disregard the cyclists, but most vehicles is still the biggest threat to cyclists and pedestrians. It's about safety for everyone and consideration being shown from everyone. If we all show a lot more consideration, then there is some space there, we can use it better, and that's part of what White House is trying to say.
Francis and then Steve.
Can I just say, in one of your paragraphs, you say you don't need specialised equipment. Of course you do. You need helmets. In one of your paragraphs it says. At page 62 where it says, seen as a normal everyday activity not required specialised clothing or equipment.
I think we're just jumping ahead there, Francis. That's the next item. But if you want to comment on cycling equipment, because obviously there's what a responsible user would do, but also there are different legal requirements on it, so I don't know if you want to give a comment.
At the moment, the law in this country is that you don't need, there is no legal requirement to wear a helmet. It's an incredibly muddled research field. There is research that suggests that helmets increase safety, but in turn, when you have a collision, that's when you've had a collision, and already you're not safe because you had a collision. There is also research that shows that you're more likely to be involved in an accident if you're wearing a helmet, because motorists pass you closer. They won't, they don't show the same care and attention around cyclists that are wearing helmets. So our position as Sustrans is that we're entirely neutral on helmets. We believe that if there was a law that mandated helmet use, then the level of cycling would drop, and the consequent level of deaths from obesity, diabetes, heart problems, and health issues would outweigh the benefits. So we remain neutral on the position. Personally, I don't always wear a helmet. My children, I do encourage them to wear a helmet, because where helmets are best is into those low speed collisions when you perhaps just fall off. So
yes, like the younger ones when they're going to school, they should always wear a helmet. It's health and safety.
Yeah, that's my personal position. But as I say, when we work with children, you'll see in our report that there's pictures of people with helmets and without helmets, and that's because we reflect that it is personal choice. My personal choice is that my children wear helmets.
The other thing is, there's that many potholes in the roads, even side roads. It's safer to wear a helmet than not.
As I say, it's a personal choice, but also if we're saying that it's almost like the whole debate about helmets makes it that the only responsibility of cyclists' health and safety is their own, and actually wearing a helmet makes you safe, it doesn't. Actually, if you're in collision with a car, helmet will not necessarily save your life. If you fall off the bike, it might. But if you're in a collision with a car, the injuries to the rest of your body, sadly, means that you may not. So if what we're saying is that helmets make people safe, they don't. That's why Bike Life Report is important, because it's about the whole environment, not just what cyclists are wearing.
Steve?
Yeah, so a couple of issues and questions. I've mentioned this before as a member of this committee. There's often a challenge to local elected members when they see dedicated cycle tracks but alongside a road that's full of potholes. And when you say, well, where's the money come from? Well, we can't spend the money on the potholes, it's got to be spent on cycle tracks. And then you almost get a clash. The two interest groups fighting each other. So I think it might be worth outlining where the funding's coming from for the works that are going to take place, or the sort of package, and what it can also be spent on as well, because there is often that sort of challenge. I think we were going to talk about cycle helmets. I noticed from your film there was a mixed message, some with helmets on, some with not, and that's clearly where you're coming from. I think we would have to be more careful in the message we give out as an authority to say, well, don't wear a helmet if the next thing someone has a head injury, and I think we would have to be quite clear, fairly unequivocal in our advice, and with high-vis gear as well, in the dark nights and so on. I would say high-vis and helmets would be a must for me if I sent anyone out on a bike, or went out on a bike myself, which I do. So. That would be my particular side. But where the funding's coming from, the source of the funding, and what sort of things that can be spent on might help members.
That's a very good question, which someone can answer for me. At the moment, we've got the Sustainable Transport Enhancement Package programme. We've got about £42 million programme on investment for sustainable transport for this across the city region. 2021. We have also got proposals for ERDF for the improving sustainable level development strategy strengthening, which if successful is a further £16 million to implement sort of cycling and walking measures. Clearly, Transforming Cities Fund gives us an opportunity over the next 4 years to get some additional funding. We know as well that we're actually working with the Department of Transport on building a business case for further investments in cycling and walking infrastructure, which they're hoping to present back to the Treasury. And I think that's primarily in recognition of an awful lot of the work that's actually going on across the city region that perhaps we haven't always shouted loudly about. What Bike Life will allow us to do is shout very, very loudly at the national level about a lot of really good work that's happening across the city
Mark?
Yeah, just I disagree with Steve to some extent. I think that the helmets thing is once again, it's an aspirational wish that we should all wear a helmet. Fortunately, this day and age of austerity, lots of families can't afford to buy a bike, and when they do manage to afford a bike, I'm sure the last thing in their mind is being able to buy an additional helmet, which they're not cheap, they're quite expensive helmets. So I think we have to be mindful there are situations within society where people will not be able to have an helmet, have a proper ride with a helmet. Our personal choice is I don't ride with a helmet, but that's my personal choice. And once again, it's freedom of choice. When you get to the realm of imposition, saying you must, is when we get to a dangerous realm. Especially if it's not going to be funded by the government. If you want more people to wear a helmet, then they should fund it.
I suppose I'll just sort of sum up as well, kind of just trying to put a hat on the helmet debate. Obviously it's one of the I'll bring you in a minute then, Tony. But obviously kind of yes, it should be best practice, but obviously like riding a horse, it's not kind of legally required that you've got to wear a helmet, so there is ultimately that element of individual choice. I suppose one of the questions I just wanted to ask really is kind of in totality as a city and the city region, I understand we're the first city region to be doing the park line, what practically do you think we'll achieve from the process? You know, when we sort of sit here in a few years' time, what do we think will come out of the other end? Because I think it sounds really exciting, but you know, it's almost just to kind of visualise the kind of nuts and bolts that could emerge from it.
I suppose the best example is if you take Greater Manchester. So their second, when Andy Burnham stood for election, we were able to give him the 2015 report, and he was able to start to realise that maybe walking the cycling had a wider support. When he appointed Chris Baldwin as his walking the cycling commissioner, partly because he realised that how important it was, Chris Baldwin was then able to work with us. He wrote the introduction, and then as a result of that, he produced his Made to Move manifesto, which is probably the most ambitious proposal for walking and cycling in the UK. If he's successful with it, it could eclipse London. He cites bike life as a major part of that. So that's a clear example of what bike life can do for a city.
Okay, well, there's sort of proud competitive neighbours. We look forward to meeting the lads and lasses down the M62. But
I thought you would like competitive
neighbours. Absolutely. Yeah, sort of in the right way, sort of nosy neighbours. Yeah, kind of, we want to see them do well, but we're quite confident we can do better. So, Tony.
Yeah, I welcome more bikes on the road, because every time there's a bike on the road, it means there's one less car on the road. There's one less pothole on the road, because the cars are actually making the potholes, so therefore it's a circle. But what I don't get is we invest. I drive a cab, so it's in my interest that there's more bikes on the road, because when they get punches, they get cabs. when the weather changes, they get cabs. So they put the bike in the back of the cab. I'd like to see the ability of buses to actually take them as well, so that more people think, well, if I do get a punch, yeah, I can get a bus home. If the weather does turn, I can always get a bus home. So I'd rather see them on public transport, on the bikes, and out the cars. Because the traffic situation everywhere is getting to such a point now where it's not only the carbon issue, it's the economy is suffering because people aren't moving around efficiently enough. But what I really can't get, and I can't get my head around this, is we've invested a lot of money. I work in the Kerry area, and we've had a lot of cycle paths put in, specifically designated for cyclists. Yet the cyclists don't use them, they use the road. It's a lot more dangerous on the road, but they still use the road. I'm not paying to actually stop them on traffic lights and say, there's a cycle path over there, it's safer for you. But they choose to use the road. And the investment that we're making is not being used. So I think it's a point of asking the cyclists, what exactly do you want? You know, do you want a dedicated cycle path, or do you want extra room on the road?
In response to that, I don't know the specific cycle paths that you're referring to, but one of the things that Bike Life can do is look at why that behaviour is happening. It can be that whilst the cycle path is there and you as a motorist feel that cyclist would be safer, they've made the decision that that cycle path isn't safe for whatever reason. And if it isn't safe, then we need to know why and we need to put that right. Sometimes it can be the fact that, you know, there's dogs and pedestrians on that. Sometimes there's too much broken glass. You know, there are all sorts of reasons as to why a cyclist chooses not to cycle on a cycle. Sometimes it's where you join a road. Is there, as you join from somewhere where the access to the cycle path isn't, it's easy to access the road. There's all sorts of things. So it's difficult to say, but that's why I can work with that.
Patrick. Thank you, Chair. I am aware that the fitness industry has grown like topsy. Over the last 20 years, we've seen a massive increase in the number of gyms. I speak locally as well. There's about 4 or 5 gyms around where I live. And interestingly, what happens is you go to the gym, and there's something like 75, 80 car parking spaces and 7 spaces for bikes. I mean, my question is an observation, I suppose. Question is, as part of your research base, will you be working with fitness organisations, gymnasiums, to look at how they are encouraging people to actually use bikes in a practical way by looking at enhancing the services they offer for bikes?
I always find it quite bizarre when you go to the gym and you actually drive there, park, go to the gym and then on a static bike and pedal away slowly for half an hour. Just get on a bike and don't bother with the gym membership. Walk more, it's free. I've never understood why people pay for gym membership when you can walk and cycle and do free activity. And it's much better than me.
So the question
in answer to your question, for those who do want to have a gym membership for whatever reason that they want, yes. Again, this comes back to the cycling and walking infrastructure, but I think I'm thinking more and more putting a little bit more of a comprehensive report back to this committee, because a lot of the questions that are being asked will be addressed through the Bike Life report, but in the more immediate future, we've got this BLC, but the things have been quite formed and things have been back here, so at a future meeting then, I'll be interested in that. We'll be working with by many stakeholders, themselves and clues to develop that plan. That plan will go nowhere without having one to have to do
for.
Frank, did you want to close? Thanks, Chair. I think there's been an awful lot of very valid points made there. I think the next paper actually gives us the opportunity to try and generate some of the answers to some of the points, because it does pick up the use of helmets, it does pick up training and education for drivers, it does pick up infrastructure needs and issues. So I think if John takes us through the next paper, that is the response to the call for evidence, I think you'll see that within that there are a number of points that have been made that will help address some of the areas of concern that have been flagged up.
Okay, so there's no further questions on the presentation. Now, first of all, thank John for presenting the report and video. Thanks to Nick for coming along and sort of we look forward to you coming back with the sort of results of the report. And obviously we can move the recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report, because one of the points that sort of Steve was making as well is about where the funding comes from. I think in what we're endorsing here, we shouldn't forget that this is actually kind of third party funding. You know, this isn't sort of taxpayer money, we're actually getting money from an alternative source to do what should be a very exciting piece of work. So I think, you know, all in all, it's something we look forward to kind of working with and seeing what the results are. So if we can agree the recommendation of paragraph 2, if that's okay. Yeah. And moving on nicely to item 9, which obviously is the call for evidence around the cycling and walking investment strategy. And John, that's
firstly, this is by way of an apology more than anything else. The time sales for this were completely out of sync with how we do things. The response had to be submitted to the Department for Transport last Friday. So in advance of this meeting with the Commission, the Chair, and with the Director General of Mercy Travel, drafted a response Taking into account a lot of views from across the city region, so all of the local authorities, from our colleagues in the health sector, our colleagues in the Mayor's Agro Safety Partnership, formulated the city region response and submitted it last Friday. So what you have attached to the board as the appendancy is more detailed response from the city region. That's been submitted to government. And what governments have said, they'll consider all responses and then be brought back. And I suspect that will then form into all five pieces of work in terms of what we do around safety around cycling and walking. Just to take you through it, I think just in terms of the summary, if you look at page 61, paragraph 3.13, there were six questions that were asked as part of the response that we put into the city region. And the first one's around infrastructure and traffic signs. And I think this is a recognition that there is inconsistent approach nationally to how traffic signs and infrastructure is done. One of the things we're doing across the city region, again through the recycling and walking infrastructure plan, is we're developing a Liverpool City Region cycling and walking design guide. So again, if we were to say to Nobsley, can you build a cycle path from Purple Customers then to say Tower Hill, for example, it would be designed to one standard. A similar cycle scheme in Wirral would be designed to a completely different standard. And because we want to get the best possible infrastructure for the city region, what that to be consistent so it looks like a single offer across the city region in terms of the strategic network. Design guide would say, if it's going to be off-road, we expect it to be built to this standard for high level of servicing, lighting, signage, so people feel safe and comfortable to use that infrastructure. The laws and the rules of the road we've already touched on. But this again, this is a wider issue about the law. This is all about education, training, publicity, and how we can use that more effectively. I think in terms of the law around cyclists and the rules of the road is a little bit of grey area. And this is probably the key issue that kicked this consultation off in the first place. You know, we're rather unfortunate against them where that cyclist is prosecuted because he killed somebody who was riding on the pavements. And that's what starts that. So again, we write a little bit in there about these diversionary courses, which have been enormously beneficial car drivers and reducing the offending. And I actually attended one of these diversion courses quite recently as a Minuteman server just to see how they operate. And it's a really good course. And one of the things that we're looking to do is kind of develop something so that we can help the cyclists. So we're working with the best cyclists for the road safety partnership on developing that. Training is a big issue. One of the issues that we keep out, of course, is we get money for building these facilities. We get very little revenue support that actually allows us to go out and cycle training or publicity campaigns or we can change campaigns and things like that. And again, that's quite a big part of our response to saying to the FTL, you can't really do one without the other. If you want to build the infrastructure, you need the resources there that help support people to use that infrastructure. We've got educating road users, and again, this is about, it's not only about educating road users, it's also about educating our spatial planners and our housing developers to say, you know, if you're going to put a new housing development in with 200 plus houses, encourage them to build cycling and walking facilities in, and actually reduce the need for having car parking spaces on all the drives. And there's good examples in the world where that happens. Vehicles and equipment need to touch on the other issue of wearing cycling helmets. One of the bigger issues as well is the state of some device that we've been on the road as well. A lot of the suggestions that we do make is a car has to have an LMT, why don't we have a similar system where a bike has an LMT, but do it in such a way that it doesn't become a barrier to people cycling in a way. And again, this attitude to public awareness again, pointing back to two things that we do have in the city region, which we are doing, which are two actually quite innovative pieces of research. One of them is with Liverpool John Walsh University, with some clever bottoms who I don't pretend to understand how this works, but if it does work, it would be brilliant. And we're doing a piece of work on the hazards of cycling research study. And what we're effectively doing is we've got data from Merseyside Police. In the past, this is where cycle patterns have happened, and we've been missed with the consequences. And so what John Moore's doing is they're building as a model that can predict future risk on the network in terms of cyclists. So as the number of cyclists grow, we can use that data to predict where accidents may happen. But the data is that sophisticated, it can actually predict what the outcome will be. So whether someone will actually fall or slightly hurt, or whether someone's likely to be killed as a consequence of that risk. That will allow the dentist to one of three things: is it an education measure, is it an enforcement measure, or is it an engineering measure to actually alleviate that risk. One of the other things that we're looking to do is when cyclists are on the network and they're cycling and they're going to the risk hazard, we're looking to develop an app where they can be given an early warning system. So if you're approaching this, you need to take out immediate action. That's in development now, and that will be ready in October this year. And we're looking to showcase that at the Smart Travel Eye event in October. The other piece of work that we are doing, that again, that's commissioned by Liverpool City Council, is a piece of research with a company called SOMO. And these are the bright, more creative people who are based out of the Big Triangle. And again, these are looking at the issue of pedestrians. The number of people who pedestrians have been killed on roads nationally are increasing. It's disproportionately higher in Liverpool than it is anywhere else in the country. And so, several will be involved in to examine that in a little bit more detail. And there is some research that people do sentiment, which you see, which is absolutely fascinating. And so they've done some background research into the insights, to what the main causes are, and they're now moving into the second phase of research that actually build the solutions. Nobody else in the country is doing this, particularly for the walking stuff. It's the most comprehensive study around walking risk in the country, and will be predictive of the cycling. No one else is doing it. It's enormously innovative, and we in the city need to make a banner of this. Again, we need to work with the councils on helping them build the case for more funding to make the cycling more consistent.
Thanks, Chair. Read through your reports and certainly some very good stuff in there, but I do have to say it is very disappointing again to have a report which is already gone. Hindsight's a wonderful thing, and I'm one of the best in the world at it. But even if it was impossible, and I accept that I've got to be occasions, surely it could have been emailed out to us however days in advance would enable to us, because there's something factual in there which I wouldn't want to comment on. That's that. The more important thing in many ways is the report to me is a little bit contradictory. At page 62, of the initial report, not the report to government, as has already been commented, it says safe instruction would encourage use of routes without the need for specific cycling or walking gear such as helmets and high visibility. Now, I accept at the moment at least it's a choice matter, but I also accept what Councillor Fowke said, which is we have to be very careful that we don't give the impression that we're supporting one or the other, and that could be read to say that we are supporting not wearing them. I do apologise for your colleague's name, and I'm not, I promise you, being insulting. When listening to what you said, it was a little bit like listening to President Trump with his guns, don't kill people, people kill people. And also, a lot of the arguments put forward were the same arguments that were put forward before seatbelt became compulsory. Now, I don't infer that you don't generally hold those views, but I do think you have to revisit them to have a look at whether it is being realistic. And I do say that, of course, quite obviously, because I think helmets are a good thing. I think we have to do that. But
But looking at the report at page 73 again, it's refreshing this, encourage use of routes without the need for specific cycling gear such as helmets. And yet at page 72, it quotes, for example, the USA study conducted in 2008 found that 91% of cyclists killed were not wearing helmets. The study further found that helmets reduced the risk of a head injury at 85% and brain injury by 88%, and severe brain injury by more than 75%. Without saying whether it should be one way or the other, it does seem to be a bit contradictory in putting the two things in our response. We seem to be pointing the different ways in the same response. Then the final point is on page 70. And this is one where I certainly would have felt that the position in Hobart would have been useful for you to know. What it says is, in recent years, some local authorities have taken off the enforcement of parking and some motoring fences. This appears to have had the effect of reducing the risk of prosecution for some offences and softening attitude towards parking offences. Holton does not have responsibility for parking and traffic offences, and nobody can remember the last time anybody was prosecuted by the police for parking or traffic of that kind. And the answer is very simple, and I'm not being critical of the police, but the answer is very simple. The police say they just do not have the resources to do it. This implies that if you have the police doing it, that's good. If you have the local authorities doing it, it is bad. Now, that may be the case in some instances. It certainly isn't the case in our experience. So, going back to the very first point, you or other people may not accept the points I've made. That's fine. The problem was we didn't have opportunities to make them before it went off. And I think it would have been helpful. It's gone now. I'm not from Manchester, but I've got a good Manchester expression I like is the donkey down the field now. So there's nothing we can specifically do about that, but I hope that those points, if you believe them, there are, will be
looked at. Yeah, absolutely, and I fully accept that. And I'm denying the people who said this event comment before, and I fully accept that and endeavour trying not to have that in the future. One of the things I will try and do is I will try and speak to contacts within the departments and see if they will accept slightly later laws from the city region that incorporate those calls, and if they do, we advise accordingly and send that in. Fully accept and say, what will they accept? Absolutely.
Frank wants to come in, then I've got John again. I fully understand the point that's being made, Councillor Howard, but I do see what the response is trying to say, what the report is trying to say, that in any risk management process, one of the first things that you need to try and do is remove the risk. And I think what it's saying is if the infrastructure was right, if the equipment was right, if the training was right, and if the behaviour was right, you would not necessarily need the helmet. But what it's also saying is that the evidence is that because all of those other risk mitigation measures aren't in place, incidents are happening that mean that there are serious injuries and fatalities taking place, which the use of a helmet protects against to some degree. So I think it's not arguing that you shouldn't use a helmet, it's making the point that because other issues aren't effectively addressed, the use of a helmet is a sensible and appropriate measure, but it's not the answer to the problem. The answer to the problem is trying to address some of the root causes rather than put the protective measure in place.
I'm afraid, Frank, I disagree with you 100%. You sound like Donald Trump. The guns don't cut young people. I've got three children. At one time they were young. I've got three, four grandchildren. I should have better example. If they were on my drive with nobody else anywhere near them, I would want them to wear a helmet, because falling off the bike for an injury, it won't guarantee anything any more than seatbelts in a car guarantee anything. But I wasn't trying to argue that we should wear helmets. This is my view. wasn't arguing that. What I was saying was that we should not in any way be giving the impression that we believe not you wearing high vis or not wearing helmets is something you should do. If you remove all the risk from everything, you can still get killed. That's absolutely right. But you, at the same time, should also take every possible step to ensure that you look after yourself to the best of your ability. Now, that's what I disagree with when you say that if all those other things were put in place, there might be no need for. Even if you put all those other things in place, in my view, you've still got a responsibility. If you don't want to use that responsibility, it's your affair, you still have a responsibility to try to keep yourself safe.
And I don't think we suggested that people shouldn't wear helmets. I think it's saying one thing in one context and a different thing in a different context, but I don't think it's contradictory.
Agree to disagree between Arian and Frank on that. I've got John, then Gordon, then Terry.
Thanks, I hope we're agreeing to disagree amicably, colleagues. thank you very much, Chair. My point is about, I was a little bit surprised, John, that, thank you for the report, by the way, I was a little bit surprised that there weren't any exemplar material from other countries who are much more further advanced on this agenda than we are. For example, Holland is a very good example. I'm just wondering, I appreciate the constraints of time that you're under and the pressure that you've been under, and that's already been mentioned before by Harry and other colleagues. But I do find it a little strange that there is not exemplar material in there giving examples of best practice from abroad that we could actually implement in this country and more specifically for us here in the Liverpool City region. So I'm just wondering what your comments are on how that would be. Thank you.
In terms of the response of the department, brevity was the lost way. They didn't want long, detailed response. We have spoken to them privately about the examples of best practice elsewhere that they should be spoken about here. We constantly go out and scan some schemes from across the UK and the rest of Europe where we want to implement here. London in particular, Nick, there's some really good stuff down there in terms of what they're doing about the forest, stuff that's happening in Edinburgh. Walking infrastructure in Bristol, where they concept of continuous walkways, but if you're at the pedestrian equals to a road junction, usually the pavement stops and then the road kicks in. You don't just continue the pedestrian environment. And it gives the impression that, not that cars aren't unwelcome in the area, better feel that the pedestrian is more important than a car driver, which is absolutely should be the case. The pedestrian should be top of the list when it comes to the road use a hierarchy. So in terms of putting it in the response, from DFT's perspective, they didn't really want that level of detail. But when we were looking behind the scenes, we didn't want more of that level of detail. And then we would always bring stuff back to the committee for review anyway.
Yes. Briefly come back, Chair, for me. Yes. I appreciate all of that. I'm just wondering if it's possible for us in a future report to come back to us and give examples of that best practice. Just referring back to the previous agenda item in terms of bike life, how we might best implement the infrastructure that is required to get cyclists and pedestrians.